sharks, it has been found recently that within them they have found not only creatures that were dead, and assuming they don't normally attack unless there's blood, and that would presuppose death having occurred, at least under more docile, gentle conditions. But they have found clocks and anvils inside sharks' bellies, indicating that they're not simply out after the nearest living system to devour, but respond electromagnetically. Now, it's also been demonstrated that when our minds are pure, we give off a different signal than we do when there's a chaotic, a discordant mindset. But here's some information that I think this audience would appreciate. Some years ago, I was at Texas A&M University. My wife was in the hyperbaric biosphere, hyperbaric medical chamber, not the biosphere. I hold the patent on the biosphere, but that's a hyperbaric oxygen facility at Texas A&M. She was taking treatments under conditions quite similar to what we have had in the pre-flood world. She had an open wound on her foot that normally takes 2 to 3 weeks to heal, but under hyperbaric context, greater atmospheric pressure, and enriched oxygen, that wound healed in 45 minutes.
Wow.
So we can see that under this context, with the supply of oxygen in the atmosphere, but also due to Boyle's law having to do with gases, and you've worked with that in physical science, Boyle's law would saturate the water table with this available oxygen under these higher atmospheric pressures. That would eliminate anaerobic bacterial problems that we have today. That's rampant worldwide. So we wouldn't have the discordant signals being given off under those conditions. So these creatures that could clean up the problem wouldn't have a lot of problems to clean up.
That's right.
But Dr. William Fife, head of the hyperbaric lab at Texas A&M, also former head of the entire biology department at that university, after hearing the creation model, said, I want to tell you a story. He said, maybe this will add a chapter, or at least a paragraph. And it did. As I tell this story, with the background of this great predator, he said, we ran an experiment on a university campus, and he was a biologist and had medical training as well. He said it was not on this campus, but it was another campus. He said, we built a huge aviary, an avium for birds, yes. A huge bird cage. He said we had birds of all sizes and all kinds. And he said it took a couple of years for everything to settle into their niche. And he said after a couple of years, when everything was settled and they were developing and hatching, he said we decided that we needed to add some water. So we built a little fountain, a little pool. Then we decided we needed some fish in the pool. And he said, we placed in that pool, inside this huge aviary, we placed the most predatory, aggressive North American freshwater fish that we could find. Now, help me determine what that might be.
Probably a muskie or a northern pike or even a largemouth bass.
Okay, muskie, northern pike, largemouth bass. Those are predatorial. They're aggressive, but they have a limited range of food supply. He said there is another species of fish and a variety within that species that will strike for a much broader range, and that's what we got, the brown trout. He said, it'll go for minnows, it'll go for worms, it'll go for bologna, it'll go for peanut butter, it'll go for bread, it'll go for meal, a much broader range than those other predatory creatures that you described. So he said, we put some fingerling brown trout in the pool. We couldn't get them to eat. He said, we tried everything over a course of years, everything. Minnows, worms, meal, couldn't get them to eat anything, but they kept growing. He said, Dr. Sharpe, he said, when we took them out, He did his hands like that. He said those trout were that big. They were gargantuan, but they had never eaten anything. He said, we finally determined it was the bird droppings provided the nutrient salts that were simply assimilated by the brown trout. They never ate anything. They were not aggressive. They were not predatorial. They were contented, but they continued to grow. In this world of the dinosaurs, under pre-flood conditions, and certainly under Edenic conditions, we have a display that would not require aggression.
No, sir.
But would be satisfied. Now, that brings me to this final conclusion. It is not enough for you to be satisfied with academic pursuit and gratifying realization of mission accomplished. But you have a vacuum in your soul, a vacuum that only God can fill. Men know everywhere that there is a God, they just do not know who he is. They know there's life after death, they're not sure where it is. They know they have sinned and they have no liberty from that sin. They know there's a judgment and they have no hope in it. Let me give you some hope. The Creator walked with us. He shared our counsels. He loved our children. He went to the cross. He died for our sins. He was buried, but he arose from the dead, and he's now alive. He's knocking at your heart's door. Would you pray this simple prayer? Just pray it simply with me. Dear God, I'm a sinner. I need you. I know that Jesus is knocking at my heart's door. Lord Jesus, right now, come into my heart. I open to you. Save me. Cover me with your blood. And I will serve you with all my heart.
Creation in the 21st Century has been sponsored by Trinity Broadcasting Network. And only with your love gift of support can this program stay on the air. So write to Creation in the 21st Century, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711.
Information like you've received today is available at the Creation Evidence Museum. In printed form, in videos, we even have a coloring book for the kids. Just call or write us at Creation Evidence Museum, P.O. Box 309, Glen Rose, Texas, 76043, area code 254-897-3200, or check us out on the web, creationevidence.org.